Well, welcome to Wine Decoded. We've got a very special guest here today. It's Giuseppe Russo from the estate Girolamo Russo on Mount Etna, producer of some fantastic lava juice, as we like to call it. Giuseppe, thank you so much for joining us today and coming all the way to Australia.
It's a pleasure to be here for the first time.
Yeah.
It's a very emotional for me because to come to Australia was for my father. That my father is Girolamo Russo. Was a dream.
Yeah.
And I am here for this reason. I'm very emotional.
Oh, fantastic! It's great to hear. I hope to fulfill one of my dreams as well, to come to Sicily and perhaps visit you and see your vineyards. It would be wonderful. So, for those of you who know Wine Decoded well, you will have seen that we have a lot of wine from Etna. We love wine from Etna. I think over the last 10 years I've been drinking wine from Etna, and it's been an amazing experience to try something new. Some people call it, a cross between Barolo and Burgundy. I prefer to say it's just bloody good wine from Etna that has its own personality, and it's a beautiful one. But I'd like to start perhaps by talking a little bit about the history of Mount Etna and the changes that have occurred, because I like to call it what I call the Jurassic Park of wine. So it's like dinosaurs were there at some point, they all died off, and now everyone's coming back to Etna and making wine, but they've managed to find the dinosaurs again and grow them. So in the history of Etna, when did wine start being grown on Etna, and how have things changed in recent years?
I understood very well. The history of Etna is a glorious history of viticulture. Traditionally, the viticulture is very, very interesting. It's glorious because some old vines. But about the wines, has been a history of bulk wine.
Mm-hmm.
Wines made for the local market, for the private use, or for to sell to some negociant that especially from the north side of Etna bought this wine and blended this wine and then sold the wine to the other part of the world, of Italy, in the Danau, North Italy, the North Europe, and there is a port in Riposto, very very close to the production area of Etna, and there is a train that arrived until this port. And it worked. It worked to this commerce all time. Since 60 and until 90 years, crisis, deep crisis.
Mm-hmm.
The surface of the area the reduced.
less vineyards, and only the best vineyards
the best vineyard where the viticulture had made a sense, because there was a local market in the 1990 years, very deep, a crisis.
So the industry, the wine industry on Etna had really just become subsistence. So it's just to supply the local market for their need to drink wine.
The local market for the viticulture, some viticultures survived.
Mm-hmm.
Only for the local market.
Yeah.
And selling the grapes to other to big producers, mm-hmm. In the, some locals, but also no locals. The only the last buyers for Etna grapes, mm-hmm. and Nerello Mascalese grape. Nerello Mascalese from where from Calabria.
Oh, okay.
Per cui, okay. Used to make very cheap wine.
Yeah.
In the 20 years, the situation changed, mm. Because of the arrive in this area, of some producers, good producers quality wines other areas, mm-hmm. Tuscany producers
Franchetti, Marco de Grazia,
Frank Cornelissen, that understood the potentiality of this terroir and decided to invest in this area. Mm-hmm. Example: some producer like me decide to try mm. to change a way to make wine, mm-hmm. and think about another way to make Etna wines.
Mm. So Etna is very interesting for me because it reminds me in many ways of parts of the Australian wine industry, because over the last 20 years. You've seen very rapid change with new people, new technology, different focus, a focus on making quality wine,
yes,
and very fast change. So changing, yes, very quickly. What's it been like for you learning again about Etna, about growing vines on Etna and making wine?
But I didn't. Fortunately, I learned for the first time.
Yeah.
Not again.
Yeah.
Because my father grew the vineyards with, but my education was different.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think to. To cultivate the grape, the vineyard, mm-hmm. Before. Mm. My education is different. I studied classical music, literature, mm-hmm. to make a teacher, to make other jobs. Mm. And when my father died in 2003, the situation was changing, mm. For the reason I said before, and I decided not to try was arrived.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And I decided not to sell the vineyards. Mm. Only for this reason I start to cultivate.
So this was a very important moment. You had a choice to either sell or stay,
yes,
and make wine. And so you chose to stay.
I decided, yes, to stay, and but staying with my education, I couldn't make the same work of my father. Mm. I had to change the way. Mm. And I decided to make a good wine of quality mm. wines.
So you saw that opportunity.
In a part, I had experience of the tradition to cultivate the grapes of my father that my father left.
So, as a boy, you worked in the vineyards?
No, as a boy, I didn't work, but they talk, my family talked always about the the cultivation for me, not so far, no, this world.
Yeah.
But and I decided to continue to use this method to cultivate the grapes. That, in a part, the tradition of the viticulture. Mm. In another part, another the come dire, I knew that I this the system to make wine no good. I needed to change the system, and I decided to look for a help. The help arrived because I found a young enologist, when in Tuscan enologist that come dire, decided to help me, to work with me. And this enologist is Emiliano Falsini. Now is a famous name of the enologist in Italy. Mm-hmm. But 15 years ago, he was
just beginning.
Yes.
Yeah.
And for us has been a bet. We start the first vintages. I started to select very well my grapes, to understand the right maturation, the difference of between an area and another area, for the maturation, for the quality, and I start to make micro vinification to understand better and better the qualities of this grape, and. When I about the vinification, I called my enologist to know how to make every step by call a colleague sometimes he came to have a look and I start to make wine
it's a very big we call it a leap of faith you just go for it and say I'm going to try but you don't know anything. So your head, it's going crazy, huh?
I'm very lucky because I was very lucky because I met some people that helped me very well and at the right moment, right moment.
Yeah,
my enologist, some a friend of my the for the labels. That I like my way labels very well. I think that they are very recognizable.
Yes,
They gave a power of the bottle.
Yes,
my bottle, and is a gift of a journalist. Now is a very good friend of mine, American journalist. That she was for case in on Etna, and she met me when I was trying look for a good label, and she offered me a collaboration, a free collaboration for free.
I think this kind of thing happens when people have passion and they love what they're doing. Even if they're doing it badly in the beginning and you're still learning, if you're passionate and people see that, they want to help.
Yes, maybe. Yeah, I don't know if I understand. Maybe they understood the passion,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
The effort I was making in that moment.
Mm.
Yes.
Well, you have some very good vineyard resources. Some very good vineyards and sites, some very good contrada to work with.
The good contrada, not for my merito, for my capacity, but I for the capacity of my father and my grandfathers before, because all the I have now in the vineyard I have was of my family, and San Lorenzo, feudo di mezzo. My father, my grandfather before, choose these these areas.
And even though they were making wine that wasn't necessarily, you know, as good as you are now, they managed to find the good sites. So that's you're very, very lucky. So
that's.
So moving to today, you've now had almost 20 years. 15, 20 years, yes. making your
wines. I started to first true vintage is 2006. Mm-hmm. The first vintage is 2005, but I didn't. The first vintage in my cellar is 2006 with with my hands. The wine made by my hands is 2006. Yes,
and
we 14.
So 14. In that time, you learn a lot and things change, particularly when you're just new to making the wine. What have been the big changes in the vineyard for you? What's changed in the vineyard in that time? No.
In the vineyard has been to make a very traditional viticulture, more than my father. Because my father, in the last years, needed to make some compromise because he hadn't some money to make a right cultivation. Per cui a traditional cultivation, a little correction. About the quantity, especially the quantity of the grape, okay. Less grapes.
Yeah.
First years, very small productions because I want to make the most concentrated wine, the best wine on the Etna.
You want it
after? After some, it was ingenuity. It was an ingenuity of the beginner, no?
Yes.
And after some years, I corrected this this aim. No?
This is very common.
Very common,
and very common in Australia in the 1980s and 1990s. Everything was bigger.
Bigger? But was a aim because I remembered when the buyers of the grapes of my father speak no good of Nerello Mascalese because they said that these grapes no good to make wines for bottle, and for me was important to demonstrate that the Nerello Mascalese, with Nerello Mascalese, if you wanted, you could make a fantastic wine. Mm. And in that moment, a good wine was a big wine.
Yes. It's a problem because a good wine is often just a fashionable wine. It's true to fashion, not necessarily a good wine.
Yeah, absolutely.
And now, this is interesting that you say that because as I've tasted wines from Etna over the last 10 years, I noticed more sophistication, more elegance, more restraint, more purity. So the fruit is really, you know, number one. Less oak when were trying oak. Less oak now. Did you ever try using new oak?
Using first years, but necessarily because I started and I to make to buy
practical.
Yes, I use new oak because sometimes I have to change the wood in my cellar.
Natural cycle.
But the this year I use more and more bigger barrels.
And then the
barrique or tonneau. I continue to use barrique or tonneau because especially used because of my method of vinification.
Yeah.
I started to make micro vinification. I continue to make more and more micro vinification.
Just to learn, to obtain the
best results. Mm. It's difficult. I know very well that especially the older vines, you can find too much homogeneity. There isn't homogeneity.
Lots of different vines, different yields, different health, different maturation, different time of maturation, the same in the same rows.
You can find a plant that. Make less quantity of grapes.
Yeah.
We mature before. And it's important to obtain good results to recognize and select the plants by plant.
So you pick the vineyard several times and picking different vines individually.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
In Australia, often the approach is very different. They call it. There's a bit of a shift to precision viticulture. So they have satellite images and special machines that can go and assess each vine. And then in the very big vineyards, they can program the machine harvester to pick this vine and then stop picking this vine. But obviously you have to use a big machine. So
the power of the Etna is that the machine it's impossible to use too many machines.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The only machines are the
these ones.
The mind of the hands, the mind and the and the palate to taste to understand to choose the grapes. I use my worker that I educated in these years use the. Appunto, they made the hands their mind and their taste.
I think having studied classical music, having studied literature, it's very good for your senses and your ability to feel about what's going on. And you add in knowledge, add in some science, and the combination is quite good. So, do you think your music experience and literature experience helps you in the winery?
It works, no? But I think this education has been my luck. Yes. because I could work in this to make wine without prejudice, maybe with open-minded, I understand.
So there has been a long time in Australia where winemaking was almost passed down from one maker to the next. And this is the way you do it. And I think recently there's been a lot of young winemakers experimenting and doing different things and changing and breaking the rules. But if you come in without any set idea or way to do things from your history, it makes it easier to potentially make better wine.
Maybe, or try new things at least. My education, especially my my education to read, to analyze the scores, the classical
yes.
music, helped me
yeah.
to recognize that to make if you to make a good wine is a question of nuances,
yes.
that you
yes.
maybe catch
yes.
to catch in
some
way.
Yes, so it's important to have all of the little things.
The little things,
and they all build up to
are
make
important.
Something special.
Are important. You can build an analysis of a score of
yes.
Reading some notes that becomes a whole piece.
Yes.
No?
Yes.
But every notes it's very different of the whole results.
Yes.
Because
yes.
You can interpretate every notes. Looking at the future, the time that
yes,
diachronically.
Yes,
I don't know if there is this time this term in English.
It's called chronologically.
Chronologically.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So that makes perfect sense with wine. I think with the way a wine develops and ages and matures, and you do something here at the beginning, and it affects something at the end,
yes.
and the way it comes across. Well, hey, thank you for that introduction into Etna. I could spend hours picking your brain about varieties and clones and so many different parts of where about Etna, but I think we should try some wine. I'm very thirsty.
Very
so,
thirsty.
So should
okay.
we try your white or your rosé first, or shall we try them together? We have three glasses.
Maybe they'll say.
The rosé?
They'll say.
Okay, so tell me about your rosé and how you make your wine, what you want out of a good rosé.
I started to make this rosé in 2013. This is Nerello Mascalese 100%, because I've thought to make a rosé, very different rosé than the common southern style rosé, more heavier and sweeter.
Mm.
I wanted a very vertical,
yes.
vertical rosé. The rosé could me for me, in my opinion, was had to be a soul of this grape, Nerello Mascalese, without body. We like a white, but you can feel the smell,
understand.
The smell of rosé wine. I started to make this rosé in 2013, very very cool and rainy vintage, and. The good, the very very come dire, perfect, very perfect vintage to start to start to make a rosé, and I decided to use only Nerello Mascalese because the other grape that you can find on the Etna for the as other red grape in the genus Nerello Cappuccio,
yes.
that is has more color, is more colored, and is you can make a wine a little bit sweeter, no,
yes.
fruity. And
yes.
For me, I wanted to make a serious rosé.
Cool. Yes.
Only Nerello Mascalese, but not only Nerello Mascalese, but from old vines. I decided to use first years, only the lowest part of San Lorenzo.
Yes.
That in San Lorenzo we are at 750 meters.
Yes, and it's very high.
Very high, and the lowest part is very 330 meters. 730 meters.
The vineyards on Etna, all of the vineyards, it starts at about 300 and goes up to, you know, about 1100.
No, in the DOC area, starts in the north at 550 to 800.
Yes.
In the south, arrived to Ottawa, 1,000.
Yes.
Before, in the south is higher, a little bit higher.
The area. Some very good vineyards in the north,
the vineyard,
outside the DOC.
The vineyard, on the Etna, you can find the vineyard on the Etna also lower or higher.
Yes.
Than this area.
Yeah.
But not many. In lower, not so good wines, not so good good areas. Because the altitude make difference, the altitude especially.
Too much heat?
Too much heat.
Heat, hot.
Ah. Troppo caldo, yes.
Yes.
Less difference between the night and day.
Yes, yes. Yep.
And sometimes you can find also not only volcanic soil, but mix.
Yes.
In other
richer
areas. Yes. Richer, yes.
So for you guys, every time you go up 100 meters in elevation, the temperature drops by 1 degree. So if you go from 300 meters to 750 meters, the temperature should be about 5 degrees cooler. And so the advantage of having the higher vineyards is you have those cooler sites. Even though many people might think Sicily is hot, it can get very cool, and Etna can be the last to pick in the entire country.
Yes, yes, in the October.
Yes.
Because in Etna there is a solate grape, like Caricante for white and Nerello Mascalese for... But if you have a Pinot Noir, you can... You harvest before.
Yes.
Not in October.
A little earlier, yes.
At the end of August.
The first time I tried your Rosato, I was very impressed. I thought, this is very serious, very serious rosé, but also lots of fun. So I thought it was much more like, for me, in many ways, a very good white wine. With a little bit extra tannin.
Extra tannin.
And some of those red fruits, that's from Nerello Mascalese. This is a very beautiful wine. It has great line and length. I think there's some very good precision and definition to the wine. You get that long, long palate. And lovely, lovely acidity to this wine. I really enjoy the texture as well. There's a little bit of the tannins from the red grape, but not over the top. And a lovely delicacy and sophistication to the wine. So, are there things that you might be changing with the way you make Rosato? What's in your head at the moment? Or are you happy?
No, this is, I am very, very happy to this.
Yeah,
this
yeah
style,
well, I
this
would
style,
be.
Of this style, yes. It's difficult to obtain this style every year, but for this reason I prefer to make less wine, but make an effort to have the same style.
Yes.
Always. Different vintages, you can feel the different vintage between 18, 17, but you can recognize the same style.
Yes.
For me, it's important. For this reason, in 18, I made 15,000 bottles.
Yes.
In 17, very warm and dry vintage, I made less than half.
Yes.
7,000.
Yes, for to keep the style.
Yes.
Has it always come from San
Because
Lorenzo?
Only not in the no in the last in the last in the last years I use all also Nerello Mascalese from other part, but the best part is the mostly is is Nerello Mascalese is San Lorenzo, the lowest part of San Lorenzo.
This is such a beautiful thirst quenching wine as well, you know. It's not simple. Very complex and lovely, lovely aromas, lovely flowers, lovely spice. little bit of earthiness, a little bit of the red berry stuff. This is very good rosé, very good rosé. So thank you.
I appreciate it.
So now we have a look at your white wine. So it's made from a great variety called Caracante. Tell me about the vineyards where the Caracante comes from, and what you're trying to do with the Caracante.
Allora, my vineyards are all in the northern slopes of Etna, and this area is traditionally only for red wines, for red grapes, Nerello Mascalese. But one time, they planted some white varieties among the red plants. Now you can find the old vines, especially in San Lorenzo, in my San Lorenzo, you can find some plants of mainly Nerello Caricante, but also other indigenous grapes like Cataratto, Grecanico, Insolia, Minella, that is another Etna grape from Etna. And this wine was born for a joke, because my mother wanted ask for a white wine. Okay. I decided to make it's true. I decided to make two barrels of white wine, choosing some as a test. I changed the idea, not convinced too much. I start the project in 2010 deciding to make a few bottles of my white wines. And for this reason, the name of this wine is my mother's name. Marina is my mother. but means also a little black, because I dedicate to my mother, but as a joke, okay? As a funny.
But so is this the vines that make this wine? Are they very old, or did you plant some new ones to make?
Until 2018, this vintage only old vines.
Yeah,
only old vines. Now in the last years, I planted 3 years ago. I planted 2 hectares in my feudo, Contrada feudo.
Your mother must be very thirsty.
Yes, my mother. yes. Not enough. Sometimes I bought some grapes, but growing by myself.
Yes.
Growing by myself.
So you look after the vineyard.
Yes.
For this
grape, to add some to my grapes. And I made maximum of this wine 8,000 bottles.
It's not much. Yes. Very small.
I decided to plant 2 hectares to have a good base.
Yes. Yes.
Consistent wine.
Yes. Hard when it's planted.
Yes.
Amongst
to decide. Very hard to check the right maturation of these different grapes.
Yes.
To improve the quality of this wine, it needed to have all the Caricante I think that next years I will have to think about this wine in a better way,
as the new fruit comes in.
Yes.
And you see different things.
More Caricante, especially more Caricante. Important. Caricante is the best grape.
This is a beautiful wine. The thing that strikes me about these first two wines is the lovely texture. The way it feels in your mouth is beautiful, and I love the acidity in this wine. It's a little bit salty as well. but a beautiful core of fruit, like fruit all the way along your mouth. A nice little bit of what we call phenolics, so like a little bit of tannin that sits very well.
Yes.
It's very clean, great flavors, lovely perfume. This is a cracking example of good white wine from Etna. I think it's very unique as well. Some people say Etna Caracante is the Chablis of Italy, but again, I think it's Caracante and it's a beautiful, beautiful wine. So thank you for sharing this wine with us.
Yes, thank you.
So we have four red wines now. We move on to Nerello Mascalese and red wines. So should we try the Etna Rosso first and then try the three Contrada together? Would that work for?
No. I tried since my first vintage. I made Arina, that is a blend of different Contradas, and San Lorenzo. Mm-hmm. Since 2006, vintage, I made both Feudo and San Lorenzo. Mm-hmm. I started to make Feudo di Mezzo in 2011 and in 2017 the new entry Caldera Razzottana. Mm-hmm. Until now.
Own all of those vineyards? For the whole time, or is there some new vineyards?
Young vines that I planted in 2005, 2006 in Feudo. Then, and last 2-3 years ago, another part in Feudo, half hectare in Caldera Razzottana. Mm-hmm. But I don't use for my single vineyard selection, single vineyard wines.
Yes.
Only the younger vines goes to my Arina wine. That is to my blended wine. Until now, it depends. No, I don't decide. I decide every year. But until now, I always choose the wine from old grapes to make for my selections.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But.
15 years old, the vines are starting to get to a point where you think maybe little bits can go across.
I think that the older vines, you can obtain more deepness, more complexity. But it isn't a rule. Every year I can decide.
Yeah.
To.
You have to taste.
The tasting is the best way. To make several selection, to keep separate every micro vinifications, and then understand how the wine
comes. I think this is natural. There's no recipe. You have to just do your best every year.
No recipe if you come if you start from the vineyard, from the grapes to make wine.
So tell me about Arina.
Arina is a blend of different single vineyards. This is a result of micro vinification I make. This different selection during the harvest. The harvest is late on the Etna in October. Starts about 10 October and could finish also in the first week of November sometimes.
Yeah.
And I start to make, and I use the grapes from my younger vine and some older, also of the older vines. Nerello Mascalese, but there is 10% of Nerello Cappuccio.
Yes. So do you think Nerello Cappuccio, by comparison, does it provide a little bit more sort of generosity and sort of richness, or what does the Nerello Cappuccio add to the wine?
Nerello Cappuccio, in my experience, is a little bit more colored, less tannic, more fruity. You can obtain the wines not so, cioè, come dire, elegant, but a little bit soft than Nerello Mascalese.
Sure.
It's good for my Arina that arrive before to the market.
Makes it a little more approachable.
More approachable, drinkable.
As a slightly younger wine.
You can't wait to drink this wine.
Mm-hmm. Well, also. I think this is a very delicious example of wine from Etna. Everything is in the right place. Again, lovely flavors, lovely tannins, nice little bit of grip in the front middle palate, and good length. I think there's some lovely generosity, but the thing that always strikes me about wines from Etna is the complexity in them. And in this case, I think with your wines, I always find them to be very together, very harmonious. Maybe it's the music.
But this is, I don't know if there is the music, but maybe it's my hard the research of the maturation, the right maturation of the grapes.
Yes.
Every bunch that come in my arrive in my cellar must be perfect.
So you select in the vineyard.
You can obtain the right balance between the maturation, the sweetness, the sugar. The sugar it depends on the vintage especially.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a very warm vintage, you have more sugar.
Yeah.
Sugar. But if you make a good cultivation, you can obtain freshness that give a balance.
Yes.
To the sugar.
If you look after the vines, they ripen a little bit earlier, the grapes stay fresher, you have more natural acidity, and your wine comes across, it's fresher. So if you look after the vineyard,
yes,
it makes it easier in the winery to produce fresh wine.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think.
Mm. So you select in the vineyard for fruit, and then you also select in the winery as the fruit comes through?
No, only in the vineyard. All done in the vineyard? Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
All in the vineyard.
Well, let's get to the highlight for today. Let's try the three contrada. So tell me about the three contrada, and what are the differences between the sites, the vineyards?
Different soils. Yeah. Around this the vineyards and on the Etna, you can see how the soil change continually.
Yes. So the age of the lava flow.
Yes. Yeah. Different lava flow, different ages of lava flows, and for this reason, different composition, not the same composition, chemical composition between a part and another part.
Yeah.
Is the vineyard, the single vineyard, had the results of the soil, the character of the soil, characteristic of the soil, the microclimate that there is in that soil, that areas, and also the plants that grew in that soils.
So,
all Nerello Mascalese, but not always the same Nerello Mascalese.
Yes. Yes. So I read some research that said there's probably 100 different Nerello Mascaleses.
100 different biotypes, maybe.
Yes.
Because every area has its own
yes.
Nerello Mascalese that
yes.
in some civil maybe. Adapted in that particular soils.
Yes.
This makes the difference. I don't know if the difference, the different character between Feudo Di Mezzo, San Lorenzo, is difficult to explain if you think about only the soil.
Yes.
Because the soils that change continually, also in the same contrada, could be, if you analyze the soils, with chemical analysis, are very similar.
Yes.
You can find the different, but in a, I can say that Feudo Di Mezzo is more sandy that Feudo.
Yes.
But it not it, it's not enough to understand the difference of this, the character of the the wine that results after the vinification. It's a strange mix. It's a strange mix of different, things. Different the soils, the microclimate, the difference of the system of cultivation, the work of the man.
Yes.
During the time the age of these very old vines.
Yes. Yes. So. Which is the oldest and the youngest lava flows of these wines? Which one is the oldest dirt and which one is the youngest?
The youngest in this wine, maybe Feudo Di Mezzo, maybe. But yeah. I'm not so sure because it's difficult to understand very well the age. I know, for example, that some part of Feudo of San Lorenzo is very very ancient, for some in opinion of some geologists, because maybe in some part of Feudo of San Lorenzo, but not only, maybe in Caldera Sottana or in Guardiola. In the surface, you can find very, very old soils of all the lava flows.
Yes.
When that is a very, very old ancient period of Etna. When the behavior of the Etna was very, very different than now, that the modern period of Etna.
Yes. Really very, more
active and more explosive. No, effusive but explosive.
Yeah.
And you can find some stones are a little bit lighter than the common stones. No like pomix, but and this is. The soil more softer.
So
softer.
It's broken down.
Softer, with the drainage is better, and the root could go.
So more nutrients, more energy for the roots. So
to go deeper.
Yes. So. This is fantastic because we're smelling three wines that are very different from each other. They're very unique, yet when you look at the map, and we'll put the map on the video, they're really not that far from each other. Oh, San Lorenzo is a bit further away, but Fuera di Mezzo and Caldera are virtually next to each other. Almost next to each
next
other.
To yeah. Yes, but in my opinion, San Lorenzo, there are differences between Caldera and San and Feudo Di Mezzo, but not so like Feudo Calde San Lorenzo. San Lorenzo has a characteristic molto different, different than unique than the other contrada wines. Yes.
So I first tasted these wines when they came into the country. When was that, James? About 6 months ago? Or 4 months ago?
September.
And now, very different. They're very different wines. They've settled down completely. Well, not completely, but they've settled down and resolved. They've come together a lot more. There's much more harmony in the wines. Initially, I thought, is there some new oak in San Lorenzo?
No.
No.
In San Lorenzo, I use big barrels.
Big barrels.
Big barrels. Yeah. 2,500 liters.
Yeah.
And
San Barrique.
Okay. San Barrique.
So it's funny because initially I thought maybe there was a little bit when I first tried back in September, but now the wine looks so together.
San Lorenzo. Sort of, yes. San Lorenzo usually is. It needs to wait a little bit more.
Yes.
To appreciate this.
Yes.
Wine.
Yes. Yes.
Caldera Sottana and Feudo, that my other single vineyard, maybe is are more immediate.
Yes. Mm. So I think the Foro di Mezzo looks.
The tannins are stronger, but the smell is more.
Yes.
Expressive before.
Yes. Yes.
San Lorenzo, you have to wait and to understand the deepness of San Lorenzo.
Yes.
And it needs more meditation.
Yes, yes. So it's interesting because I see much more feminine wines with Foro di Mezzo and with Caldera. The Foro di Mezzo is definitely more expressive now. Some lovely perfumes coming off it. Yes, there's some robust tannin in there, but it has the fruit to support. It's good. Yeah. The Caldera seems almost the most closed today. You know, sort of quite tight, but I can see that just with some time in the glass, with a few hours in the glass, it will start to open up.
Yes. There are very, very young wines. So,
yes. And the San Lorenzo, definitely a lot of generosity, a lot of richness there. It is the biggest of all of them, but by no means big compared to, you know, what we might be used to in Australia with a Heathcote Shiraz, for example. But there is some generosity in the wine, and it really has come together beautifully over the last few months. I'm really loving where that's gone. So three very different, very unique wines, wonderful expressions of these different sites that obviously have such crazy variables, picking vine by vine, different dirt, and different fermentations for you happening as well. Just one last question before we sign off. Where do you see these wines going? How do they develop over time? What happens to these wines when they get older in bottle?
But the evolution is not like, no, of this wine. It always no linear.
Mm.
But you can find this wine. Sometimes more open, sometimes more closed.
Mm.
I can open the only. How to say? Sorry.
It's okay.
I think that this wine are very aging.
Age well.
Yes. Age well. Because, but my experience very short. But if I open some bottles of 2006, I can have a very good surprises.
Yes.
Very young wines.
You can
find.
Yes.
I can find very. But I can't explain the how is the elevation, the aging,
the evolution.
Elevation, because it's changed continually in the bottle, this wine.
Yes.
And you can find a 6 more closer than a 10.
Yes. Of course, like anyone.
And the same vintage could in a different moment could be now could be too open, 2 years more.
Yes.
Could be
close again.
Yes.
Sure.
Yes. This is my experience.
Yes. These are opening up beautifully in the glass, even just with this little bit of air. Particularly the Caldera is starting to blossom. Some lovely flowers are coming through, and a lovely perfume is starting to pop up. Three excellent wines, guys, worth trying together. Get a group of people together, grab all three wines, try them together, because you'll get to see three very different wines that are three great examples of just how good Etna can be. Make sure you start off with a rosé and a Cavalcante, because the rosé, the good rosato from Etna and the good white wines from Etna are phenomenal, and they're really very good value too. So Giuseppe, thank you so much for coming around. It's been
Thank you for the hospitality.
No problem. I wish we could eat a big meal now together and drink the rest of these wines and see how they evolve over the next couple of hours, because you have some beautiful, beautiful wines. What you've achieved in 15 years is phenomenal from someone starting from scratch. And I'm loving seeing that in Etna as well, that people have now had enough experience that their wines are becoming continually more sophisticated, their wines are becoming better, the mouthfeels are becoming finer, the textures. Etna is a place to watch. I think you'll see year after year some fantastic wines coming out of Etna. We look forward to continuing to drink your wine and lots of it, if your mother doesn't drink all the white wine first. So thank you again, and we hope to see you in Sicily sometime soon. Cheers,
Giuseppe. I'm with you.